Hey everyone, Tim once again with the Word of Life Church. Our address is 3342 Midway Street, Knoxville, Tennessee, 37921. That is the Word of Life Church. Our pastor there is Junior Mount, and you know what's coming next. As always, on behalf of Pastor Mount, the congregation, and myself, want to give you an open invitation. Come out and be with us for service, if at all possible. If you're looking for a church, just recently started serving the Lord, got saved, praise the Lord, hallelujah. That's exactly what you need to do. That's the greatest thing we can do in this life is gain salvation and lead others to the Lord Jesus. That's our commission after we get saved. But come out, check us out. If it's not for you, if the Lord has other plans for you, then you know we'll pray that the Lord's plans and He, you know, His plans be done and His will be done. And He places you, as always, as I like to say, and it's true that He places each and every one of us in the body of believers at a congregation where He wants us, that we can work and grow and help our brothers and sisters in Christ. And as I said, be a worker in the field, you know, gain some, if at all possible, you know, go out into the highways and, you know, that just compel them to come in. And, you know, that's the commission, to seek and save that which is lost, and to destroy the works of the enemy, the devil. I didn't want to do that, Luke, train of thought. I was looking at something, looking at my online Bible here, my train of thought. Anyway, excuse me, that happens sometimes. If you go to another church, of course, and you have church on a different night, then, you know, we'd like to come out and visit us. We always like to see our brothers and sisters in Christ from other congregations. But, you know, if you have service on the same nights and you're not an evangelist, you know, stay at your church, you know. Not that we wouldn't be glad to see you, but rather you be at your church, because we don't want to pull anybody from their work and where they're supposed to be in church. We're not about that whatsoever. We're not about pulling people out of their congregation. If they've made an obligation to a particular church and the pastor and that congregation there, then you need to be there to fulfill it and to support the pastor and that church and that congregation. Just as we would do there at the Word of Life, you know. We wouldn't like if someone come in trying to drag people out to come to their church, and hazard to say that no one else wants us to do the same thing. So it's just wrong belief to do that, because as I said, if God places you somewhere that He wants you, then that's where He wants you. So hang in there, stick in there, support your pastor. He needs it, believe me. Pastors, don't, people don't, a lot of people don't realize the strain the pastor and the pastor's wife go, they don't realize the strain that they go through and all the stuff that comes along with being a pastor. Sure, these younger ministers, when they come out of seminary or they, you know, get called at a young age and such, you know, you're full of fire, and it's like, you know, they would probably jumping at the bit to get a pastorship somewhere. Well, God's word tells us that not to be a, you know, be a bishop, basically be a pastor of a church, you're not to be a novice, you know, lest you live to be lifted up in pride. It's, you know, it's a job. It is a job. You know, I've never, you know, been evangelist for a while. You know, I'm not did a pastorship yet, because that's just not my calling, at least right now, anyway. You know, who knows what the Lord's going to do in the future. But, you know, we definitely want to obey His will. And whatever He wants, you know, He will give you the help and the strength. And that's not saying you're not going to have battles, but you're going to have battles no matter what you do for the Lord, because the enemy's going to fight you. And we're getting back into that today. I believe you'll have to, let's see. I believe this will be either, I'll have to look either way. I think it'll be the third one that we've done. Get back into the topic of Satanism. I believe we've done two already. I've slept since the last time we did that. But I want to get back into that. And I believe we left off the last time kind of touching on the subject. Now, we did the first one, and the first and second one kind of talking about the lower level type Satanists, you know, like I would classify, you know, as like a high school kid, or actually even younger, that's sad, that dabble in this stuff, don't fully realize what they're doing or what they're unleashing by doing what they're doing, and how much, you know, damaging their, what they're doing to their souls. But we're going to get into, like I said, this will either be three or four. Either one, it doesn't matter. Either way, I'm going to get into more of the mid-level and talking about it and talking about the various aspects. And I'm going to include, now a lot of this is going to aggravate a lot of people out there, but I'm going to talk and include some of this with the roots of talking about paganism along with it, because in many ways they go hand in hand. Now a lot of people are going to disagree with that, get mad over that, scream at me over that. Whatever, you know, go ahead, you know, you can deal with the Lord, because, you know, it's by His will that we're disseminating this information and giving it out to be a help to people, especially to people that, like parents that have kids that they're bringing up, younger kids, that's even preteens and going into teens, and everybody remembers your teenage years, how precarious and how rough in a lot of ways that it was. So that's one of the reasons why we're doing these, that and several different other reasons. Yeah, by doing so, we're not trying to, I'm not trying to put down anybody or put down any person's parenting ability or putting down their child or something like that. No, on the contrary, I'm just trying to send out a warning and give some of the signals that you might get from your child. And you know that this can also work when it comes to you know, the large problem, and this goes hand in hand with some darker pagan roots and into the satanic realm of pedophilia. You know, I think I said it maybe last video, you know, I'll just say this: if it were my child, there would be a lot of restricted access to computers and phones and such, because they, you know, there's people out there. You guys know there's people out there that specifically prey upon children. You know, don't have to tell you about the whole Catholic Church ordeal. You know, but it's more widespread than that. That's concentrated on. But there are people that are pushing that it's okay to be a pedophile. Oh, that's just, you know, that's just whatever. And that goes along with some of the old beliefs. Now, let me say this. I'll try to remember to give the church times a minute, but I want to get this thought out. There was old beliefs that that come about, you know. But let's start with the Wiccan, what they call the Wiccan read. It said, and thou harm none, do what thou wilt. Basically, they're trying to, you know, white it up, make it all nice and neat, and make it, you know, a person that's a Wiccan. Now, like I said, I'm not giving a free pass to the Wiccans. They're still lost. They need the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. They believe in a horned god and a goddess, and they worship nature and, you know, dance around trees and maypoles, sky clad, you know, basically nude, and do nature worship and everything. Generally, you'll find that they're not the ones that are doing the bad stuff, okay? But like I said, I'm not giving that religion, even though they'll say, oh, pagan has its roots before Christianity. Well, doesn't matter, because that's when the Lord decided to come and, you know, started our Christian walk, because we needed a Savior. So doesn't matter if the older beliefs are older than Christianity or has roots older than that. It doesn't matter, because the Lord came, and now we have no excuse. We must be born again. And that only comes through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let's get started talking about this. Now, like I said, I wanted to separate the two. You know, there's people that practice, you know, different aspects of paganism. You know, Wicca, you know, witchcraft, which, you know, is wrong, okay? Bible clearly says Old Testament, New Testament, wrong. You're getting information and power from sources other than God, Yahweh, or, you know, the one true God. There are gods, many lower G gods, Bible talks about. You know, basically they're the sons of God, the B'nai Elohim, or lower angels. You know, we went into that. We talked about that with the Book of Enoch, and in the Word of God, it talks about these sons of God. You know, in the Old Testament, they were angels. Now, we're after the cross, praise the Lord, we've become sons of God, okay? No, we haven't become angels, but we've become, by adoption, hallelujah, the children of God, you know, the sons of God. We've become joint heirs to the throne of God with the Lord Jesus. Wow, that's amazing to me. Think about joint heirs to the throne of God. Can't get much better than that. Gooder than that, as they say down here. So you have neo-paganism, you have neo-druidism, but different, many different nature beliefs, okay? You know, nature religions and stuff like that. Last night and today was one. In fact, I put out a video about that, talking about Beltane, you know. I hope and pray that everyone prayed against the dark powers that was going to be summoned last night and today, and the sacrifices that were going to be done, ritualistic ones. And I just hope that it was in effect. And I know the Lord hears and answers prayer, so I believe maybe lives were saved, maybe lives were changed, maybe people saw the error of their ways and turned from their wicked ways and come to the only begotten Son of God, come to the Lord Jesus, because the Lord's calling them. They know there's a hole in their life. But let me flip this or jump on the other side and say this. And there again, not giving the enemy any space, but I can say this because I've experienced it. There is a major draw in your flesh, and even in some areas in your heart that you can't explain. You know, there's something missing there, but a lot of people go into the occult to feel that. And the occult and all that stuff is very seductive. Very, you know, it just draws you in and just draws you in. And if you have an experience, you can't really explain the draw that it has. Now, I'm not saying experiment with it to try that. No, by no means at all. You stay away from it. Now, if you want to study it and, you know, share the information as a teaching tool for people to, you know, to avoid this and know what to look for in their children if they're doing this to help, you know, to do that, then that's all fine and good. You know, that's why a lot of people say, you know, everything you have of the occult, get rid of. Well, I agree to that. I agree totally. You know, if you've got, you know, wands, crystal balls, if you've got anything witchcraft related, get rid of it. Burn it, throw it away, do something, destroy it. Now, I have a few books that explain some paganism and Satanism and stuff. But I don't use those. They're not tools to me to use in any kind of ritual. They are information written directly by people that's researched it, that's talked to people. And actually a few of them, especially some of the Wiccan and paganism beliefs, are actually written by them. So by their own admission, it tells exactly what they do. Okay? So there's a lot more than people just realize. See, people lump things into, you know, the occult heading, but there are many branches and many areas and everything. One of the most vile and dangerous ones of it is Crowleyism, named after Aleister Crowley. Okay, now I don't know if anyone's heard of that name, but if you want to do a lookup on Aleister Crowley and get information, you're going to find people that say he was just misunderstood. Let me tell you something. Aleister Crowley was one of the most evil people to have lived at the beginning of the 20th century. Okay, I think he died in 46, 47 or something like that. But he had a ton of degrees and like a very high in Freemasonry, Satanism, created his own, basically his own religion. You know, the, I don't know if anyone's ever heard of the group, the Ordo Templi Orientis. It was part of that, founded that, and a very, very evil man. Even called himself the Great Beast, or 666. Would do anything. You know, he would. He honestly would put some of the Satanists to shame by what he did, doing some of the stuff that he did. Was a pedophile. There again, you're going to find a lot of information. People say, oh, he was just misunderstood. He didn't do all that. No, by his own admission, by his own writings, he said this stuff. And people that were with him and, you know, that still practice it these days. But that's something you don't hear very much about now, is it? You'll hear all the good stuff. Oh, we deserve recognition as well, you know, as a religion. Okay, well, and civil and stuff, yeah. According to the way our laws are, then yeah, you have to be recognized. Look, there's Wiccan churches and Satanist church of Satan on military bases, the same that there are any other Christian denomination. They're protected under the First Amendment, okay, as a gathering, a religious gathering. Now the Church of Satan, I mentioned that earlier. Now they don't believe now that that was founded by Anton Zandor LaVey. I got the middle name right. Zandor, I think, but his name is Anton LaVey. Started the Church of Satan. But he would talk now a lot of the stuff they do is still demonic, still evil. But they would vehemently deny, and still do to this day. He's passed away, and I think his son still runs it. Say that they don't believe there's actually a being called Satan. They just glory. Let's just try to break it down as easy as possible. They basically saying, you know, do what you want to do. You know, they might deny that, but they say, you know, they want to recognize the carnality of man and do any acts, and that's, you know, whatever, homosexuality. And I don't even want to use that. I want to use sodomy because it's biblical. You know, they can't stand these made up words to try to legitimize something. So, at any rate, you know, and of course, got a lot of his ideas, and everyone did. That created these splinter groups and these Satanist groups. A lot of them got their ideology from this man Crowley. And like I said, if you ever want to read about an extremely evil man that, you know, like I said, you know, he had degrees out the wazoo. you know, high, like I said, in the high mason, as a Freemason, and you know, he started a lot of stuff. He was just a very evil man. Did a lot of rituals. Actually, one of his children, I believe his son, I don't know if he had more than one son, I can't remember exactly, but I know his son died in one of the rituals that he did. Basically, he died, you know, broken, never actually worked a day in his life, an actual job, so it was, died depressed, you know, down, just used up. It's a shame. People don't have to take that route. There is so much a better route of light instead of taking the route of darkness, because all that's going to do is lead you to the lake of fire. You know, I know people talk about, well, you know, this is going to send you to hell. If you don't get saved, it's going to send you to hell. But you got to remember that hell and all that, and if you is going to be eventually cast into the lake of fire where there's eternal punishment. Now I want to read a little scripture, and this is the original. This is where, well, people say it started. It started for us as the human race. Now, beforehand, you got a lot of people that preach and teach about a pre-Adamic society. That's not the focus of this. We might get into that and look at the merits of that and see what people have to say about it and some of what I may think about it and give them opinions and everything. But let's go to Genesis 3. And everybody knows where I'm going. I would hazard to say, if you know God's word and study it, how it started out. And as far as the human race goes, our race. And Genesis 3 and 1, it says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman," yea, ask the question here, "yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" Starting to reel her in right now. "And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But," verse 3, "of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die." Okay, and here we go. He's reeled her in, and he's got the hook set, and he says, verse 4, "And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die." Lie right there. Very first, lied about it. Verse 5, it says, "For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." So he's lying to him. Saying, you know, God just doesn't want you to have what he has, his knowledge and all his power and to know good and evil and all this stuff. Wish we didn't know evil, right? In verse 6, "And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food," see, she was strong up to that one point, "and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat." So let's lay in the equal blame here. Woman was deceived, but Adam should have stopped it right there. Should have stopped it. Nope. Not doing it. Not taking of it. This being has lied to you. Now, you're going to find a lot of different people have varied opinions. People believe that basically that it was, you know, a snake, you know, in a tree, you know, that Satan used, basically. You'll find that, but also you'll find it talks about a little bit, you know, when the serpent has been cursed and, you know, will crawl on his belly. Well, you got to consider too, we still have snakes. I've seen them around here. You know, these here we have a bumper crop. Seems like every year of what's called black rat snakes, they seem to climb trees. You know, they try to climb these trees and rob nests. You know, but you have some people that believe it was strictly just a serpent that the enemy was using. But also, have another that. Let's go a little bit deeper. We're talking about a being, because the word used there for serpent is the word nakash, and it can be used as a serpent, means serpent, but also as an enchanter or enchantment. Believe that up to this point, this reptilian being actually, you know, wasn't, you know, we see these drawings and paintings of, you know, Adam and Eve and the serpent hanging in the tree. Well, maybe it wasn't like that at all. Maybe it was actually an actual being, the fallen angelic being that may have, basically a reptilian type being, walking on two legs, being an enchanter, being subtle, you know. That's what some people believe and preach that and say that's probably what it was. But other people say, well, it wasn't. And there you get into a lot of ideas talking about dragons and, you know, the dinosaurs, which up to a point, you know, the word dinosaur wasn't invented until like 1850 something, I believe. So before that, they were called dragons. And we know it talks about dragons in the Bible. So anyway, you know, no settled opinion there, but I've seen some good evidence in the original tongue and languages and the way that the early church and the Jewish fathers read this and understood it. I've seen good evidence to indicate that that was what took place, that it was a being, because, you know, after that point it said he was cursed to crawl on his belly. So before that, what was he doing? Was he walking? See what I'm saying? Well, no, because, you know, he was climbing a tree. Well, snakes still climb trees now. We have actual snakes that are tree dwellers that stay basically in the trees. We have some, I've seen it, that will actually inflate the front, and actually you see them squiggling through the air using the air currents to land on trees and everything like that. So you see where I'm going with that. You understand, you know, that even though there's a lot of them that crawl on their belly, dust, you know, shall be their meat, you know, but still we have some that crawl on trees. So I think we're talking about a little bit more than just a simple serpent hanging in a tree being used as the enemy. Just because, like I said, also the word Nakash can mean enchantment or enchanter. And that goes into a lot of other stuff that I definitely can't go into right now. Not that I don't want to, but it's not the focus, and it would take, man, it'd take more than time that we would have. Start making these an hour and a half or something if we get into some of this deeper stuff. So at any rate, that's lie started right there. Now, what happened beforehand, you know, apparently the enemy had fallen before this point, okay? And actually, we kind of talked about it in Sunday school yesterday morning. I mentioned it that, you know, Lucifer, you know, talks about he was, you know, the covering angel, you know, and had an anointing and was beautiful and was basically he was an archangel like Michael, you know, and kind of along the same level. Well, you know, he let that pride get a hold of him. We talked about this in the last two, you know, I'm just kind of going back over. He let that pride, you know, in the book of Isaiah, he talks about the five I wills. He said it, you know, he said, I will, you know, I'll set my throne above the throne of God. Well, as I said, that ain't going to happen ever. So he got cast down, but he was powerful enough, as you know, says his tail drew a third of the star. I mean, the angels of heaven dragged them down. Now, that's kind of separate from the sons of God, the B'nai HaElohim talked about in the book of Genesis, chapter 6. That was an angelic rebellion of their own making. Okay, so, but the beings that, or the entities, fallen angels that he swiped out, follow him, you know, and that's the thing today. I mentioned it yesterday as well. Angels at this point could still, they have free will, they could still rebel. And still, okay, and the Bible does say that be careful of what we say, you know, because we may entertain angels unaware, okay? Does it say good angels or bad angels? Or does it give an indication? It really doesn't give an indication. So you could be entertaining a good angel that's looking after you, that you meet, or it could be a fallen angel. And there's actually people that have this belief. And you're going to say, oh, he's getting way out there with that. Well, no. Look, you know, for to put away the box that your head is in, okay? I'm not being mean, just saying, just take your head out of the box, open the box, let yourself breathe for a little bit. And some of you, and I'll say this, I'm not being mean, but some of you pull your head out of the sand and take stuff in. Study to show yourself approved. Study these things. Look at, because we need to know, because we need to share it. So what's this got to do with salvation? Well, this started out, we've got to know this stuff to help, because if you're witnessing to somebody that's into something of the evil nature, of a satanic nature, you got to show them, of course, the love of God, but you also have to show them and point out, saying, you guys do this, you guys do that. Do you not know how wrong, how evil that is? You know, same way with any other religion. People concentrate on the Muslim religion, the Islam, and witness to, you know, Muslims. And some are getting saved. You know, I heard testimonies that the Lord Jesus has appeared to some of these Muslims in dreams, and, you know, said, you know, hey, I'm the Lord Jesus. I'm real. You know, I don't know exactly what he said, but basically, you know, they're getting saved. Some Messianic Jews that still keep the Jewish, you know, still keep Torah, but also they realize that Yahushua or Yeshua, Jesus, was the Messiah that Israel had been waiting for. You know, just believe it 2,000 years later, 2017, years later. But anyway, getting back to what we're talking about. So, earmarks we've talked about. And the last one mentioned, especially for investigators, people looking into this stuff, what to look for. We mentioned that. Anna said, no, because I would be the same way. Know what your kids are looking at. Know what you're doing. Hey, there's stuff, and hopefully there's a lot of you parents that know this. A lot of stuff you can't, I don't know, I haven't really messed with a lot on, like, you know, iPhones and Android phones to know what you can, but I'm sure there are programs on there too. But, you know, there's stuff that you can use to block programs, you know, block certain websites from your kids seeing it, and only you have it, you know, an access to be able to shut that owner off, you know, with a password or something like that. So they can't go to certain sites, and, you know, because let me tell you something. There's predators out there. I know this is kind of leaving heavy on child talking, but we just got finished, well, yesterday and today, a satanic ritual holiday. Well, also the pagans use it too, the Wiccans and everything. But as we talked about, the Satanists piggyback off of the pagan calendar and use those holidays. And, you know, Beltane is a big one. Of course, Samhain, Halloween, is a big one. Yule at Christmas time is a big one. You know, 21st or the 23rd, depending on the year. So, like I said, I'm not... You know, like I said, I feel like some people's going to think, well, he seems like he's kind of taking it easy on the Wiccans and the witches and everything. Well, the Bible says we're not to do witchcraft, okay? We're not. It's an abomination. God says not to do it in the Old and New Testament. So, as I said, I'm not giving them a free pass on anything. They still, as I said, still need the Lord, still need to repent from what they're doing and turn to Yahushua, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, and gain forgiveness for their sins if they want to make heaven their home. See, they don't believe, you know, believe in just nature and, you know, I could spend entire just going through the various beliefs and, you know, nature-based religions and beliefs, and, you know, it's a, so we just kind of lump all those in what we talk about in pagan beliefs. But as I said, I wanted to concentrate on the satanic because that's where you get into the area of the dangerous stuff, the ritualistic stuff. Now, a lot of times you won't get the full truth if something gets reported on something, a murder or something like that. A lot of stuff gets left out. It does. People, I mean, ministers and researchers, people that have been police chaplains, and people that know people in law enforcement get the straight skinny on stuff, basically. And sometimes when there is a ritualistic aspect to something, to a situation, you know, someone's found murdered or multiple or something like that, there's more to it than meets the eye. More to it than is reported on. You're not going to get any of the details, of course, because, you know, that's, especially if it's ritualistic in nature, no, you're not going to hear anything about it. Not at all. For one thing, a lot of the details are so bad that it would turn a lot of people off. And people say, the news reported on that. So it's kind of a quandary. You know, you can't really bring a lot of the stuff out, bring the truth out, like, say, for instance, I can on here. Now, I'm talking about the bad stuff. Yes, talking, you know, there's stuff that these people do, especially the children. And, you know, the pedophile rings and everything goes a lot of way with the child sacrifices, the human trafficking, the Satanist beliefs, young people that they're, you know, don't know good or evil yet, so their energy is very high. They want to they now it doesn't matter. I'll just say this, make a statement here. whether or not you believe this stuff or not, these people believe it and they do it. Okay? So that's why I said, open the box that your head's in and pull your head out of the sand. I'm not being mean, but a lot of you guys probably have not been exposed to this and not told about this, because I've never, of all the preaching that I've heard, I'll just say locally at the churches I've been to, I've never heard really much at all about this. Maybe a bit, maybe one or two sentences. You're saying, well, maybe that's something you don't need to talk about behind the pulpit. Well, why not? It's something we as Christians need to know about. We as Christians need to be on the cutting edge of everything that's going on. We see the world, the situation that the world's in right now, the darkness that's creeping in, that's creeping into our government, that's creeping into our churches. We need to know this. We need to know how to combat this evil. It's a spiritual warfare. Ephesians 6. Read it. Read about the armor of God that we need to put on. This stuff happens. You know, there's just so much that you can only get in and try to bring out to the forefront. And as I said, along with that, there is as I mentioned, I think in the last video, and probably the one before, there is a cloak of secrecy that these people and the enemy puts over them to where their deeds are not readily found out unless they leave signs and stuff and everything. Most of the times, let me say this, getting back to what we're talking about, the mid-level to upper level people that know what they're doing and understand what they're doing, and they are trying to bring forth demonic forces and put curses against churches and men and women of God and our leaders that are conservative and Christian. And, you know, most of the time, if they do something somewhere, you won't know that it was ever done in that spot. Thorough. Very thorough. The lower level, the kids that do it, they're sloppy. They don't care. In fact, they want to leave it so people can find it, and they get this big little rush. Oh yeah, we did that. No, you're mid to upper level, Satanist. If they do something like that, like I said, it's going to be clean, it's going to be sanitized. You won't even know they did it. Just like, as I mentioned, that testimony of that one girl that got well known in the church, and long story short, you know, they found out that they were her and her satanic group were coming in midnight to 3 in the morning, Sunday morning, and having black masses, satanic rituals inside the church. But you never know it. Totally cleansed and clean, nothing left and everything, just like nothing ever happened. But you know, people that's done that before have broke churches up. How could they do that? Because the people didn't know what they were up against. Curses and this dark spiritual power is real. They will send demonic spirits after you, after the pastor. If nothing else, if it's a girl, they sometimes will try to seduce men in the church of high authority. And they go in and try to destroy God's house. That's their goal. Of course, that's the enemy's goal as well, right? Destroy the house of God. Destroy the Christians. To try to bring about the destruction of the Judeo-Christian belief system. That's the ultimate goal. To please their master. Believing they're going to get this throne or seat beside Satan in hell and rule from people. These people are so deceived. Now, other people have been too. And it wasn't just by Satan. And people are deceived by many things. As we talked about, the Wiccan, the witches, they're deceived. They shouldn't be doing what they're doing. It's forbidden by the Lord. They need to come to the Lord. But also too, these Satanists, even the most vile and evil ones, if they've not done anything yet to seal their fate, they can come to the Lord and get out all the stuff. I've heard many a testimony. People talk to people that have been into this stuff Satanism and everything that goes along with it, that the Lord has delivered them out of it. So you can come out of it. You can. Now, sometimes you have to be careful, because once you get into the higher levels of this, it's very serious, because you'll have people that are in power that are in some of this high level stuff. And if you start talking about it, calling them out, then some people are in fear of their life and don't want their names to be told, don't want their faces to be shown. And sometimes that's not even enough. They can make you disappear if they want to. If you start calling them out and removing that veil, that's why we need to pray for the Lord, and we need to do what we can. Let's not be afraid of the enemy. You know, if you're a Christian, if you're saved, you get the Holy Ghost inside, living inside of you, you've got the backing of God the Father and the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and all power was given unto him, and we have power over the enemy. Power over the serpents and the scorpions and all the power of the enemy is what God's word said. So don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. The enemy can sling a lot of things at you. Last night we preached at Ramsey Church of God. It's a local church. If people out that don't know this area, they won't know it. And we appreciate the invitation to come out and preach. Had a good service. And at the very end, a pastor got a prayer cloth out. We anointed it. You know, God's word backs that up. It's not the power that's in that cloth. It's the sign of faith and the power of faith and prayer. Sent forth. He talked about, I can't remember if he said one of his members of his family or daughter or something like that, someone was having or being attacked in their sleep, having nightmares, you know, like night terrors and stuff like that. That's a spirit that does that. That's what these people, one of the things they try to send against the men and women of God are these demonic spirits that will do many things, cause sickness, cause night attacks. You know, like the incubus and succubus, you know, the old male and female demons that try to rape you in your sleep. A lot of people, sleep paralysis, you wake up and you can't move. Well, you know, of course the doctors will say, well, that's just a normal medical phenomenon. Sometimes it happens. No, you're being spiritually attacked when that happens. So anyway, we pray over this prayer cloth of this person having nightmares that was being attacked in their dreams. Well, guess what? Last night, I was attacked in my dreams. Yes, sir, I sure was, right after that. But having got through the dream and woke up, I won't go into detail about it because there's no point. I'm not going to give the enemy any power because, yeah, in the nightmare, it was scary, but when I woke up, it was like, you know, if that happened right now, it wouldn't faze me in the least, because I could rebuke it in the name of Jesus. Power over the enemy in the name of Jesus. Not saying that because, oh, look at me, I'm brave. No, because I've got the Lord on my side. We all have worries and everything, and problems, and we're going to be attacked by the enemy, but we've got the Lord on our side. He's made us overcomers. We can overcome these things that go on. A lot of stuff we can't take into our own hands as much as we would like to sometimes. We see and hear about some of this stuff going on. The harming of young children, of babies and such. And a lot of people won't believe it. A lot of people that have come out of satanic ritual abuse when they were a child, they would be ritually abused, and a lot of times impregnated, and would have a child just for a sacrifice. Oh, Brother Tim, you're going too far talking about that. No, I'm not. I'm telling you what happens. This is not one or two people that this has happened. This is, I don't know if I can come up with a number. Thousands upon thousands and more that have went through this. And people just recognize it as some kind of psychological disorder. No, they went through some kind of ritual abuse. Most of the time, satanic ritual, SRAs. There are certain people, certain ministries that work with people in that area. And they get delivered from it. and get them saved and cast out all those spirits that's, you know, that's inside them, and that maybe even will come. Hey, right now, before I even did this video, the same old thing happened. Those oppressing and depressing spirits try to come on you. Don't talk about this today. Just move on to a different subject. No, don't. And that's why I was like, no, I know I'm going to do it now because you're telling me not to do it. So I'm going to do the exact opposite. I'm going to call you out. I'm going to talk about it. But a lot of people are going to get mad and they're going to come on and, you know, thumbs down me and, you know, say how ignorant I am. And say, well, you know, what I'm talking about is knocking on your front door. It's reading your mail, basically. You know, we've got your playbook, okay? The Lord has given us your playbook about all the stuff that you do through His Word, through people that have come out of what you do, and many other ways as well. You know, when the Spirit of God reveals stuff to you, true, it's calling you out. And let me just say this. You're fighting against God. You're going to lose. Your God is the one that basically failed, that tried to place himself and tried to become God. Well, guess what? You know, he failed miserably. He's going to try one more time, but guess what? He's going to be utterly taken care of for good eventually. And all you are to him, your master, all you are to him is cannon fodder. Basically, he would throw you out there without thinking before he would himself. Opposite of what our Lord did for us. Instead of letting us go, he took the pain and torture and sacrifice for us. See, that's the big difference right there. We had a God, or have a God, that loves us. And the Lord Jesus, who died on the cross with that love for us, for you and I, that we might have life and have it more abundantly, and know that we'll have a home waiting for us on the other side. New heavens and new earth, new Jerusalem. I just want to be where the Lord Jesus is going to be. Hear that, enter in, thou true and faithful servant. And after that, said the pure in heart is going to see God. Hallelujah. So, a lot more I need to go into, and who knows how long this series is going to run, but we're going to get to eventually to the end of it. But the Lord's going to let it run its course. We're going to get more information and bring it forth. As I said, some of it still, you know, is horrible. I've tried to keep it not that way, to where it's, you know, but there's may have been some things I've said that, like I said, it's really not for a child's ears. You know, but these days it seems like even little kids are watching stuff on their phones and iPads and computers that the parents don't even know about. I can't tell you parents how to raise your kids, and I wouldn't try because I'm not a parent. But I beg you, you know, please know what your kid is doing. Don't let these people get their hooks in them. You know, if they're not getting, I think I mentioned last video, if they're not getting validation from you or from your church and your church family and the people that look around them that they love, they're going to get it from someone else. A lot of times that's a predator or a satanic group that'll promise you the sun, stars, and the moon. And, you know, you'll start off small, you know, and once you get in it hot and heavy, and the upper level, especially if you're in power, or have somebody in power, and you get into it with them, the harder it becomes to get pulled out of it. Because these people will threaten your life. They will threaten your life, and a lot of times that they could end up eventually going through with it. You'd end up being a sacrifice yourself in a ritual. Even all this, and we haven't hit the top echelon yet of what all this entails. This is just mid to kind of upper level, what we would call Satanists. The more serious ones that, like I said, know what they're doing, know how to summon demons, know how to sling curses toward church church bodies and members. And let me tell you something, there have been some churches that have been busted up. They weren't on the firing line. They didn't trust in God. They didn't believe in this stuff. They didn't believe in the things of the spiritual. They had a person behind the pulpit that, and I know, here we go, that's been to seminary, that's got a degree, and can, you know, teach eloquently and say every word just precise, and have this big, you know, have several degrees after their name and theological everything, but zero of the Spirit of God preaching through them. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, as long as you keep the Spirit of God inside of you and you preach with that. Don't preach with just what I learned this at the seminary and how to do this outline and just preaching, and I have it all night nice and typed up and written down and stuff like that. I'm not saying it's not okay, it's bad to take notes, no, because I do that too sometimes. What I'm saying is you have to know this stuff. It's a spiritual matter. It is a spiritual warfare matter to know these things and understand that they go on. Understand that people do these things and know what to look for. You can tell, especially through the spirit, when that dark spirit in a person or piggybacks on somebody coming in the church, the discerning of spirit is what we all need. Should be all of a sudden kick in right there. You should be able to know and see what's going on and point out and everything and say, and know how to deal with it. You don't need to be wearing these robes and a mantle with the thing of holy water, a cross, and a book on how to do an exorcism. You don't need any of that. That's just fluff, okay? What you need is the good old-fashioned Holy Ghost of God living inside of you, and do what the Lord Jesus didn't strive with any of these demonic spirits or unclean spirits, did he? He didn't have to. All he said was, go. And they left. So, brother, that was the Lord Jesus. When he left, he said he was going to send back the Holy Ghost. Well, we could have the same power. He said even greater things you would do. So we have power over these things. We need to realize that, accept that, and embrace it. That way we can deal with some of this stuff. Because let me tell you something. Some of this stuff gets you your church. It's going to wreak havoc. That's why I get nervous when I hear about people coming in and they don't give testimonies. They just come in and eventually just want to join the church and everything. To me, there are certain things you look for that ring little bells, that chime. It's like, okay, that's one mark. And then something else happens, you notice, and okay, that's the second mark. Stuff that you know. Just know what's going on. Let me tell you, some of these people infiltrate these churches. They come in every Sunday, and they would be what we consider the consummate Christian. Come in, worship, falsely, of course, you know, and put on a big act and do this stuff. All the while, they're slinging curses at the church and trying to bring it down through the power of darkness. The spiritual darkness of the enemy. There was one person, I heard a testimony that they'd been sitting there, and a person had come in and had started speaking in tongues. And the Lord opened that man's discernment, and he heard exactly what this person was speaking in tongues, and he was slinging curses and talking and speaking curses against the church, against the pastor and the members. And that started a warfare battle, and the guy prayed and other people prayed, and that shut that person down, shut that dark spiritual power down, and that person left. See how important it is? Now, I don't want you to go Wednesday night at your church, or Tuesday or Thursday or whatever, or next Sunday, and start looking and eyeing everybody mysteriously, you know, or a visitor or something like that, and thinking, but know the signs. So, brother, what are signs? Well, some of them, like I said, people come in, they don't want to go make a pass by the altar, they don't give any testimonies, they just want to come in, shake the preacher's hand, sometimes try to join the church, and put on a big show. And like I said, avoid the altar at all costs and go up and even sing in the choir and do stuff like that. There are things you can look for. You know, we can't do background. People don't do background checks on people coming to churches. Not that you would find a lot, because some of this, a lot of this stuff is done in secret. That's part of its the power. You know, it's also called the secret power of lawlessness. Lawlessness. What's the key part of that? It means secret. All this is done in secret. But know those that labor among you. Now, like I said, don't start looking at everybody with this, you know, this, you know, suspicious eye and believe that they're, you know, demonic possessed and that they're trying to come in and destroy the church, because that's not always the case. That's where we need to pray to the Lord to give us that discernment of spirits. That way we can know. You know, if a person that's just, you know, demonized and just full of darkness comes in the door, that discernment of spirit will hit somebody or multiple people, and they'll start praying and know what is going on and who it is and what's going on. We need to have that, especially these days, because everything else is being let in the church. It's no wonder that some of this stuff is coming to the church and nobody's doing anything about it, and there's no discernment, because everything else of the world is being allowed to come in the church. But anyway, that's a totally different sermon right there on top of it. But know this, the mid to upper level, and I'm breaking these, I'm kind of sectioning these off, and there's many kind of in-betweens and everything, but I'm kind of just sectioning off a little bit wider angle. When you get into, the, like I said, some of the mid to upper level Satanists, that's when it gets more serious. Like I said, the young kid doesn't know when he's playing around with the Ouija board what kind of doors he's opening. These people that are mid to upper level, as we call them Satanists, know exactly what they're doing when they're summoning demons and the dark spiritual energy to come against the people of God. They know exactly what they're doing, know how to do it, have ancient text of how to do it. See, that's what some of these other people, I mentioned that guy earlier, Aleister Crowley, do the same thing. He did, you know, he tried to do a ritual to bring forth a basically bring forth the Antichrist, if you want to look at it that way. Try to do a ritual. It was called the Amalantra Working, I believe it was called. Because he also had a follower later on called Jack Parsons. Mention him later on, that tried to do sort of the same thing. It was ritual sex magic, basically, trying to bring forth demonic spirits and demonic power. Now, I won't get into a lot this time because we're about out of time, but we might get into a little bit more about talking about Crowley and these other people. And you wouldn't believe a lot of people. Hey, right now, you know how many celebrities, I think I mentioned this before, how many singers and actors and celebrities will just come right out and say it. Yeah, I made a deal with the devil that he could have my soul, but I wanted money, fortune, and fame in this life. How foolish. It's almost to the point it's unbelievable how foolish some people are. But they did it. You say, brother, can we pray for him? Sure, we can pray for them. Just hope they haven't done something to the point that they are no longer able to be saved, such as blaspheming the Holy Ghost. You know, the mark of the beast, as far as we know, has not come out yet. You know, we're going to know when it comes out. And all this other stuff going on. That's another talk, another thing altogether. A lot of people don't even believe we're going to see the mark of the beast, that we're going to be gone before that. Another topic for another time. So anyway, we'll get into more later, but this is a good intro. Like I said, talking about more of the mid to upper level. And really, Crowley and the rest of these, some of these other guys belong in the upper top Luciferian realm. That's actually operating today in the shadows, in the upper levels of our government. And we'll talk about the Bohemian Grove next time. Place where these people gather for a ritual one time a year. We'll talk about that. A lot more. There's so much more I'm trying to get out. But anyway, we got a little bit out today talking about it and along what we need to do to combat it. And we'll talk more about that in the next video. So stay tuned. There's more to come of this. This may be quite a long series. But it's stuff we need to know. I'm telling you. It's spiritual warfare. And if there's ever a time that we needed to get our swords out, sword of the spirit, and whet them, W-H-E-T, you know, like a whetstone, you know, sharpening basically the sword of the spirit and getting it sharp, it's right now in these days that we're living in, where we can strike the enemy and destroy him. Because if he gets a chance, he's going to try his best to destroy you, spiritually speaking, sometimes physically speaking. So we're going to close with that, and like I said, this part 3 or 4, I have to look again and find out and remember exactly, but either way, it's just a number. Next time, we're going to get into a little bit more deeper stuff, and there again, give a warning, you know, about some of the stuff we mentioned may be offensive, or, you know, may not be for really children's ears, and I would prefer that children not watch, you know, even though that some people let their kids watch basically what they want to, cable and stuff. But hey, like I said, I'm not going to tell you how to raise your kid. You know, you're responsible to God for how you raise your kid. Not going to answer to me, you'll have to answer to God. So at any rate, I'm just putting a warning forward. You know, some of this stuff may be rated R type stuff. But at any rate, we'll get into that and some more next time. But at any rate, thanks for taking the time out to listen, and I hope some of this stuff we talked about at least will help start maybe opening your eyes to the things going on, and will help you start knowing how to pray for, what to pray for, like for the discernment of spirits and knowing how to combat the enemy. And we'll get into all that and more in the videos to follow. So God bless each and every one of you. I speak blessings in Christ upon each and every one of you. Thanks to you all, you spiritual warriors that prayed against this holiday, Beltane, that, you know, was last night and into today. Next, I will... You know, I'll let you know about the next things that's going on the pagan satanic calendar, and we'll pray against that as well. Amen. Amen. Spiritual warfare. Keep that armor of God on. That's your protection. So at any rate, this was Tim again with Word of Life Church, and like I said, meet me on the battlefield, and we'll all march against the enemy together. And you know what? We are going to win because of who we serve, not because of who we are, because who we serve, and our Lord and Master, Yahweh, Jehovah God, and His Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Ghost dwelling in us, giving us that power to march on to victory. So anyway, take care, and we will see you in the next video. Bye now.